Good morning. Before we begin our service, just a few announcements. So at the end of the service, we will be exiting in silence, but then going to the narthex and having a chance to greet each other. A few thank yous before we begin to Yvonne and our very extended choir. Thank you this morning. To our AV team. To all of you for coming together as an extended family in Christ. From the Oakville United Churches, and also to the other reverends who are taking part this morning. In the order they will appear, you will see Sheila Murray from St. John's, Scott Beckett from Trinity, Deborah Laferrette from St. Paul's, as well as Mary Parsons from Munns. So the inspiration behind this service today is after having presided at so many funerals and seeing how tributes were given and people feeling better afterwards, and then watching these grand state funerals for world leaders, and I got thinking, the only person who I know of who really deserved one who never had a funeral was Jesus Christ. And so that's what we're doing today. We're bringing ourselves back all those years to that first Friday so many years ago. May God bless you all. With what happened to Jesus, times like these can feel rather upsetting and frightening, but we need to remember that we are not alone. We're here amongst friends and family, and God is with us, with love that unites us, God's purpose that steadies us, and God's Spirit that comforts us. Blessed be God forever. Friends, we have gathered here to praise God as we celebrate the life of Jesus Christ. But there's more that we need to do. So yes, today we will celebrate Jesus' life, but we also commend his Spirit to heaven, grieve our collective loss, and comfort one another in our individual sorrow. I realize that for many of you, being out of your hiding places right now. It is a time of great danger with Roman soldiers and the Jewish authorities looking for us. But we are safe here. This is a time when we can let down our guard. It's okay to reveal our grief. It's okay to face our anger within. It's okay to admit our loneliness. And it's okay to admit that we do not understand how this could have happened, all the while knowing that God cares so much. Although we come together in grief, may God grant us grace, that in pain we may find some comfort, that in sorrow we may find some hope, and that in death, the promise of new life. Friends, hear these words of Scripture from the prophet Isaiah, and may they bring comfort to you. The Lord who created you says, "Do not be afraid, I will save you. I have called you by name, you are mine. When you pass through deep waters, I will be with you. Your troubles will not overwhelm you. When you pass through fire, you will not be burned. The hard trials that come will not hurt you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy God of Israel, who saves you. I will give up whole nations to save your life, because you are precious to me, and because I love you and give you honor. Do not be afraid. I am with you. I chose you to be my servant so that you would know me and believe in me." Thanks be to God what was revealed to the prophet. Let us bow our heads in prayer, please. O God, creator of all life, help us, please. Help us to accept death as a part of life, trusting in your goodness and great love for every one of us. We feel now the pain of parting with a loved one who was much too young, who suffered what no one ever should. But we rejoice that we were privileged to create memories while we experienced life with him, and that he taught us the way. We entrust Jesus to you in death as in life you entrusted him to us. Heal our hearts made heavy by the loss of Jesus, and through our tears assure us again that you will be with us and we will dwell with you forever. Amen. Friends, although we do not know exactly what will happen, we can be confident that God loves us, that Jesus Christ will always be with us, and the breath of the Holy Spirit gives us new life. Thanks be to God. And in this time when we need peace and we need solace, let us rise as we are able and sing together, "Be Still My Soul." The words will be on screen, or it's number 652 in the books.
Thank you.
And it's at times like these when we come together to remember the life of our loved one, it's important to share memories and to hear from people who knew them best. So now I'm going to call upon Jesus' mother, Mary.
First of all, I would like to thank all of you for being here today to honor my son, Jesus. I know almost everyone thinks their child is special, but let me tell you, when an angel tells you that you're going to bear the Son of God, well, that's something else completely. When we traveled to Joseph's hometown for the census, it was a real pain. I'm pretty sure you ladies can sympathize with me riding 100 kilometers on a donkey at 9 months pregnant. But on the night he was born, oh, it was all worth it. A stable probably isn't where I would have picked to deliver him, but when I saw his beautiful face, my heart just melted. Then when the shepherds came to visit and the angels were singing, what a night. But I tell you, we really knew he was something special when three kings came to not just visit, but to worship him. Mind you, they didn't bring the most practical baby gifts, but we appreciated the thought. From Bethlehem, we moved to Egypt for a while because an angel told Joseph what Herod was up to and that Jesus wouldn't be safe. But eventually, we made our way back to Nazareth. Now listen, I'm not saying that Jesus wasn't a handful at times. I remember when he was 12 and we all went to Jerusalem for Passover like we did every year. We were on our way home and Joseph and I started panicking when we realized Jesus wasn't with us. We went back to Jerusalem and we searched and we searched. Jerusalem's a big city, you know. Finally, on the third day, we found him sitting in the temple, chatting away with the rabbis and asking them questions. I said, "Son, why have you done this to us? Your father and I have been worried, sick, trying to find you." And you know what the little dear said to me? "Why did you have to look for me? Didn't you know I had to be in my father's house?" Honestly, we really didn't know what he was talking about, so we just took him home. Or that was that time a few years ago when we went to a wedding at Cana. You may have heard about that. I remember quietly saying to Jesus, "They're out of wine." You know what he said back to me? His mother, "You don't tell me what to do. My time has not yet come." So I didn't push it, and I just told the help to do whatever he told them. And then he turns big containers into wine. Really good wine. But Jesus really did care about us right to the end. When we were at the foot of his cross, Jesus said to John that I was now his mother, and to me that John was now my son. He didn't want us to be alone. And thanks for taking me and John. When Joseph and I brought Jesus to the temple when he was just 8 days old, a prophet named Simeon told us that Jesus would be a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to the people of Israel. We were a little confused but amazed at what he said. But then he told me, this child is destined for the falling and the rising of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be opposed. And then he added, and a sword will pierce your own soul too. I didn't know what that meant until today. Because watching Jesus struggling through the streets with that heavy cross and then what they did to him, sorrow pierced my soul just like a sword. So I'm really glad, I'm really thankful that you are all here today to share your memories as well as your love and support, because we really need it. Jesus seemed so convinced when he said that we would be with him again someday. I just hope it doesn't take too long.
Thank you, Mary. With everything we saw today, I know how difficult it must be for you to speak, but thank you. Thank you for sharing those memories with us. Now, I'd also like to call upon one of Jesus's closest friends, John, the disciple of Jesus.
Thank you all for coming today. This has been an incredibly difficult time for everyone who knew Jesus. Would our friend, our beautiful, loving, powerful, and compassionate friend, has been through in the past few days, nobody should have to endure. So I'm angry today. Angry that this life that touched us all so much has been cut short. Angry that he died the way he did. In the days ahead, I'm sure we will all wrestle with what it all means. I know I will. Jesus showed me over and over again just how deeply he loved all of us. And everyone around us, too. There was no one that I can think of that Jesus truly hated. He had compassion for everyone. He could get mad. He could have an acid tongue sometimes. But it was because he was trying to get a point across, and we were too thick sometimes to understand it. Jesus wasn't easy to understand sometimes. His words had a lot of meaning. The night before he died, I was sitting beside him at our last meal together, the 13 of us. He was upset. We could all tell. He told Judas to do what he was going to do quickly. If we had any real idea of what was coming next, maybe we could have done something. I don't know, but I will always wonder. Another thing he did that last night was to wash all of our feet. This man that could do so many miracles, that had so much power, he got down on his hands and knees and washed our feet. And then he told us, this is what we needed to do for each other. I watched Jesus change lives. I did not feel very loved before I met Jesus, but as we grew to know one another, he started calling me his beloved disciple. I never really figured out why. But knowing that I was loved by someone as wonderful as Jesus, by someone who could turn water into wine, that loved Samaritans of all people, that healed the sick, that let the blind see, being loved by that man has just filled me up. As Jesus died on the cross, he told his mother that I was his son and that she was my mother. I took that to mean that I am now part of Jesus' family. Jesus trusted me with his own mother's care. I don't know, I really don't know why Jesus trusted me so much. I don't think I'm anything special. Most of you know that I'm just a fisherman. But Jesus trusted me. And I'm going to make sure that Mary is well taken care of. We're going to take care of each other. I think that as much as anything else Jesus taught, that was the thing that resonated with me. We need to take care of each other. Those we know and those we don't know. That is what we need to keep doing if we are to honor the memory of Jesus. That's what he wants us to do, to love each other, to care for each other, to be there for each other in whatever way we can. Jesus, I will miss you. I was honored to be called beloved by you. I miss you, and I will see you again.
Thank you, John. For all of us, it's a difficult loss, but it's hard to imagine for someone so close to him. Well, Jesus touched all of our lives in a unique way, and we all have our own special memories to cherish. So let's take a few moments to cherish those times as we listen to the choir sing words recalling what happened, words of gratitude, and words of forgiveness that someone heard Jesus utter near the end.
And Pilate said to them, "What shall I do then with the one you call King of the Jews?" And they shouted back, "Crucify him." So Pilate, wanting to satisfy the crowd, released Barabbas to them. And after having Jesus flogged, he handed him over to be crucified. And the soldiers led him into the palace, and they called together the whole cohort, and they clothed him with purple, and after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on him. And they began to salute him, "Hail, King of the Jews!" They struck him on the head with a reed and spat upon him and knelt down and bowed before him.
Forgive them. They know not what they do.
laughter, they mocked him. They took off the purple and put his own clothes on him and led him out to crucify him. And they brought him to the place Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. And they crucified him and divided his garments among them, casting lots to see what each one should take. And those who passed by hurled insults at him, wagging their heads and saying, "Ha! You who would destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, save yourself and come down from the cross." Jesus cried with a loud voice and breathed his last.
We do bring gratitude and praise to this wondrous, wondrous life that touched us all so deeply. Let us bow our heads in prayer, please. God of comfort and peace, help us to hear the words and the encouragement of the Scriptures, that we may hold fast to the assurance of your love and the hope of life eternal. Amen. For our readings this morning, I'd like to call forward Mary of Mons.
For our first reading, we listen to these words of wisdom from King Solomon, from Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verses 1 to 4. To everything there is a season, a time for every purpose under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance. We next turn to the wonderful words of assurance from King David as we say together the words of Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And let us cling to what Jesus said to us just last night. Let not your heart be troubled. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, that where I am, there you may be also. A little while longer and the world will see me no more, but you will see me. Because I live, you will live also. Do not let your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid.
We thank God for the holy word from scriptures and also for sharing with us what Jesus had just said. Thank you as well, Mary. Well, we sometimes say about how some funerals are mainly relief funerals, and then there are others like today that are mainly grief funerals. Now, all have some combination of both, but I think if we're going to be really honest, today is more about grief. When folks are grieving deeply, as Jesus' family is, there's a danger that they can become isolated because sometimes people avoid speaking to them because they simply don't know what to say or they're afraid of saying the wrong thing. Well, I'm sure all of us and a lot of people were shocked to learn that Jesus is no longer with us. For all of us, it's a startling reminder of how quickly life can change, a reminder to us to not put off what we may be hesitating to do. Just last Sunday, he was the toast of the town, with people waving palms as Jesus entered Jerusalem on the donkey. You can see a photograph on the screen up there. None of us would have ever guessed that 5 short days later, we'd be gathered together for this. So we wonder, what happens now? Well, the sacred scriptures have been our best source of wisdom for over 1,000 years, and they reassure us of the greatest relief, that Jesus really is okay now, that he's fully restored to health, reunited with some of those who have gone before and is just beginning his new life. In the psalm that we all said together, what did we say? And I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Not a year, not a lifetime, but forever, long past when our time on earth is done. Well, later on, it would be understandable if you don't remember a lot of today, but I'm really hoping that a couple of things might stick with you. As John said, we're going to need to support each other as we go through all the struggles we're going to have in the next while. It's not going to be easy keeping going without our leader here with us, especially with all the feelings we have swirling inside. We need to talk it through with each other, because if we keep it bottled up inside and we try to deny this whole experience that we've gone through, it could really mess us up for years. And as we're grieving, you may be hurting like Mary is, or feeling angry like John just told us he is, and that's perfectly normal. Angry that Jesus could leave us so young. Angry with the Pharisees, angry with the Romans, angry with God that this could happen. But it's vital to remember that life may be totally unfair, but God never is. Jesus taught us so many times that God is like a loving parent who wants only the best for his children and is there to help us and then take us home to a much better place. But it's true, we might be feeling angry with ourselves, because grief can make us feel really guilty. There may be things we wish we had said to him, things that we wish we had done, like stopping him from coming to Jerusalem, or fighting harder to protect him last night in the garden, or maybe not denying that we even know him. Grief is so powerful, it can make people feel guilty even when we don't have any reason to feel that way. Well, there's no wrong way or right way to grieve. The important thing is that we do it with each other's help. With the help of Christ's teachings, as we look back on the things that he told us, may all of us receive the peace of mind that he offered, the comfort that he gave us, and let us all look forward to the day when we will be reunited with Jesus again in that place he has gone to prepare for us. But in the meantime, I also hope that you'll be able to concentrate on those great gifts that Jesus gave to every one of us. He gave us such great memories, miraculous things that no one can ever take away from us. And again, thank you to his mother Mary and disciple John for reminding us of some of these. Just last night, Jesus said, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid." The gift of the peace of Christ is what can give us all peace of mind. That what we may be feeling or thinking now, by the grace of God, will eventually pass. But there's so much more. Jesus said to help us that he would send us a paraclete. That has a lot of different meanings. One is helper. Could we all use help right now? I'm certain we all could. Another is comforter. As the shock of today's event wears off, we're all going to need the comfort that Jesus said he would send. But most of all, Jesus gave us hope. Hope that we will be with him again. Because again, just last night, he said, "In my Father's house are many mansions. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to that place, you will be there also." What a magnificent day that will be. Well, with Jesus' body being placed in the tomb, we might wonder, how can that be? Our minds, we can't possibly imagine what God has planned for us. And there can be ways of existing that we can't possibly understand at this time. But like the butterfly emerging from the cocoon, Our bodies may undergo a complete transformation from our physical remains. So it might not be for 50 years or more, but one day we can look forward to Jesus bringing us home as his heavenly Father has done for him. And the time of waiting here, it's going to seem like the blink of an eye compared to the joy of getting to spend eternity with him again. Well, it's clear from what everyone is saying that he brought a lot of excitement to life. He showed us how to be a true friend. Jesus was generous, and he'd enjoy the hospitality of rich and poor alike, of saints and sinners. He would even give lepers and beggars the time of day. And you could see on the screen a picture of him spending time with children of all people. You could tell a lot about someone who loves children. Your son, your brother, your leader, and your friend will live on if we step out beyond the fear we feel now and boldly spread the good news of Jesus Christ. If we don't let his memory die as well, but teach people about his way. With all the great things Jesus did, with all those great things, I'm really hoping his memory will live on for at least 100 years. I hope there will be good books written about him, and maybe even some songs. He might even be remembered longer than Tiberius. Jesus said he would be with us even until the end of the age. Lord, may it be so. And for his wonderful life, we say, thanks be to God. Amen. We're going to stand as we are able to remember as we sing together, what wondrous love is this? We're going to sing verses 1, 2, and 4, and it's number 147 in your hymn books. Seated. I Let's bow our heads again in prayer, please. God of grace and glory, we thank you for Jesus, who is near and dear to all those gathered here and who now has passed from this life. We thank you that for him all that suffering and death are past, and that he has now entered the joy you have prepared in your eternal love. We thank you for the friendship he gave to so many for so long. We thank you for the love he offered and received while he was with us here. We ask you that he may live on in the hearts and minds of his family, friends, and followers, and that his way may reach others. Comforting and caring God, we pray for the family and friends of Jesus and for all who grieve this loss. We remember especially his mother, Mary, Jesus' brothers, James, Joseph, Judas, and Simon, as well as his sisters. We also lift up his disciples, especially Peter, John, and James, and his close friends, Mary of Magdala, and Lazarus, Mary, and Martha of Bethany. May they all know the comfort of your love through the support of others and the peace of your presence. And guide us all as we seek to offer support and care to all of us who feel this loss. And we pray for ourselves, who are tested by this death, that we don't try to minimize the loss or seek refuge from it in words alone or brood over it so that it overwhelms us and isolates us from others. Grant us all courage and confidence in the name of our great friend, Jesus Christ, who on the mountainside taught us all to pray together the words of his prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come,
thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
One of the great things that Jesus gave us was hope for what comes next. And so I'm going to invite you to rise as you are able as we sing together in the bulb, there is a flower, number 703 in the hymn books. I'm going to ask you to please remain standing for the commendation and blessing. Holy God, by your creative power you gave us life, and in your redeeming love you have given us new life. We commend Jesus Christ to your merciful care. Jesus, go forth from this world in the love of God from whom you are begotten. In communion with all the faithful, may you dwell this day in peace. So these are pretty confusing days, with fear and anxiety and this whole flood of emotions. But may the peace of God, which passes all understandings, keep your hearts and minds protected by our belief in our leader, Jesus Christ. And may God be your comfort, your strength. May God be your hope and your support. May God be your light and your way, now and forever. Amen. Go in peace, knowing how very much God loves us all. Go in peace. But you know something? Somehow I get the feeling that this is not the end, but only the beginning of something great. So let's all get together on Sunday. God bless you all.